Management, are we familiar with supply chains? Have you done any work with supply chain before? Yes? No? Okay. How many of you have shopped on Flipkart? Amazon? Walmart? Alibaba? All these people are supply chain managers. The wonderful part till now is you have been the buyer. You have demanded certain quality in your service. Now what is happening is you are going to be the facilitators or you are going to be the middleman. How many of you have shouted at Amazon for not fulfilling their deliveries? Yes, all of us. And we are very happy to shout at them because we know that they hear us. Now what is going to happen? All the people are going to shout at us. Okay? So you are going to take the attitude that we are going to get shouted at, but we are not going to take it personally. Okay? We are going to work in a manner that we are still going to be happy. Okay? So this probably is the key to whatever we call a supply chain. And supply chain is a group of people or a group of agencies, a group of maybe individuals trying to fulfill the requirement of a customer. In a construction site, the customer can be your project manager. If you are the project manager, you are trying to satisfy your client. Depending on the size of the organization, you may be the supply chain manager, you may be the project manager, blah, 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 everything. Right? So, you need to remember that material is being ordered, material is being transported, material is being stored, and material is reaching the end customer. End customer can even be a mason. He is not able to work because he is not having your required Arakon blocks. Okay, so things like this mean this supply chain is key to the survival of any company. Okay, it is key. You see that these are the stakeholders in a supply chain. First, there are the manufacturers. Then you will find that you got to have a supplier. Many times the manufacturers don't directly supply the material. Okay, so that means this is the retailers whom you typically see in shops. Titan is a company. It manufactures the watches, but Titan authorizes showrooms. Okay, although the word Titan is there, it may be World of Titan everything. You will find that there is a dealership involved. So he is the one who is the face of the company. Okay, so he can decide if he wants to reduce his profit or if he wants to work at a huge premium. If he is the only supplier and he wants to make a huge profit, he is obviously going to do a lot of he is going to keep his prices very high. So many times you may not be able to directly reach the manufacturer. I'll share with you one instance of cost cutting. In one of the companies we were working, we were asked to give the entire requirement of cement and rebar on the first day of the year. The purchase department decided that across the big company, they will have a centralized order for cement and reinforcement. What is the benefit? They can go directly to the steel rolling mills and say, look, I'm willing to buy this much, 1 year of your supply, guaranteed I'll buy. So like this, you go to four or five steel mills, you can buy the whole thing at a very good price, right? Then, so it means that, you know, depends on how much you're able to buy, again, you can go to a manufacturer or to a distributor or a retailer, a supplier. Then there is the transportation. Transportation cost is something which is very variable, which can be controlled also. How do you do that? You can hire an entire train, a coal wagon of a rail, and then transport your material. That means around 54 or around 120 truck loads worth of material is being transported at one shot. But then, taking so much of material, you need warehouses. Okay. When you come to VIT, you will find that there are many warehouses. there are warehouses on the main road, but there are many warehouses on the inside also. When a train comes, you cannot detain a train infinitely. Okay, then you have what is known as demurrage. So to avoid demurrage, they need to evacuate or empty the train very fast. And the entire train's load has to be kept safe. Okay, I am talking about cement, something which is very relevant to us. So we need to have good warehouse facilities. Warehouses where a material is safe, where it not get damaged, and all the things like, you know, first in, first out, or what is the principle you want to manage. Then of course there are distributors, retailers, wholesalers, which, you know, these two may be kept as interlinked. And the last one is the end customers. So all these people are playing a very important role in this supply chain. These people can add value to each point of the supply chain. Each, in the sense that if I want to deliver to my wife for her birthday present, I ask Amazon to gift wrap, right? So this is a value addition which we are getting. Okay, so things like this is what is going to make you invaluable in an organization. So when you are buying stuff, it's not just a matter of buying it, it is also adding value to your material. It's like having, getting a cake, whether there's icing or not, that is the thing. And for everything, suppose, you know, you are able to get something without a cost, that means you are, I mean, you are a good man. So here there is sourcing. You need to source at the right place, you have to source at the right quantity, and then you have to also source with the right quality. So time, quality, cost come into the equation. This is called as the triple constraint. This is called as the triple constraint, and this you will also, if you are going through some of my videos on construction management, you will see that, you know, we keep talking about this. If I want to get something done cheaply, I will have to spend maybe more time. If I want to get something done cheaply, maybe I will have to compromise on quality. So if I want both, there is a midpoint where I need to reach, where we keep bargaining and then come to a midpoint. The next important thing is material management. Cement cannot be stored the same way as reinforcement, all of them go into concrete. Same thing goes with aggregate. Again, you are not dealing only with cement, aggregate and steel. You have paints which are inflammable, varnishes, and which are also having vapors which are more, which release more vapors. So you will also have welding gases, and you have oxidizing agents, maybe even oxygen in tanks, and so on and so forth in your site. All these materials require special kind of treatment. Okay? So you cannot simply buy cement and keep it in the sun. Again, reinforcement of different diameters need to be segregated properly, so on and so forth. So this is what we mean by material management. And the last thing is what we feel, I mean, aspect I will focus is logistics. What is logistics? Bringing material and keeping it. See, in a construction site, for every square feet of land you use, you pay rent. It means that although I can buy a train load of cement cheaply, I may need that much of cement for my power plant which I am constructing. I cannot store that much of material economically. I may need this train load of cement for 1.5 years. So by then the quality of cement might have deteriorated. So it means that I need to be very rational in the way I bring in material to my site also. Okay. So every single thing, like, you know, thinking about procuring your ready-mix concrete from a nearby place or from a far off place, from a place where, you know, you are sure about the timely delivery but which is very expensive, or whether you are planning to get it from somebody a little further off who is coming to the cost at which you are expecting the material to be delivered. So all these things are the aspects of supply chain. In every step, we try to add value in the chain. each link we build, we try to add value. Okay, any questions till now? Right. Yes, please. No. Okay. So I read a nice article. Keep an open mind, but don't keep it so open that all the knowledge spills out. Okay. So I'm going to now revisit some of the concepts of construction management, because construction whatever is scheduled determines your sourcing, in the sense where you are sourcing it from or when you are sourcing it. Okay, so basically you got a lot of stuff to think about when you speak of construction management. So let us say that you are constructing a house, somebody has asked you to construct a house. These are the three questions you will ask. What is the requirement of the house? There will be some considerations for the house, whether you can satisfy the consideration or not is the other thing which you will be seeing. Then you need some knowledge. That knowledge is something which you already gained. For example, how should I choose cement? Again, maybe is there going to be, for example, we are doing the architecture block, we are going to have some facades. So we have decided that typically what we do, we keep anchor inserts, I mean we keep insert plates which are of the same material as the material which is going to support the facade. It means when I am welding, two similar materials are only welded together. But if suppose I am using dissimilar materials, for example aluminium cannot be welded at all, and you cannot join aluminium with steel easily. And even if you join it, you have to be very careful to ensure that you got what are known as bimetallic connectors, so that corrosion doesn't take place. So this sort of knowledge is already available with you. What we are trying to do is, we are going to try to put all of this knowledge which we have into the schedule, into whatever we are doing. For example, we were discussing about a sump. The sump is 6 meter deep. Okay, how many lifts are required for pouring the concrete? So we know that at the most we can go for 2 meters. That means I cannot, although the sump is a very small sump and the quantity of concrete is very little, 6 meters cannot be raised for the same day. It means although the material is known, the quantity of material will be 30 meter cube. It means that day 1 I require only 10 meter cube, day 2 10 meter cube, day 3 another 10 meter cube. This is the way the 30 meter cube is going to be brought to site. Okay, it doesn't mean that, you know, we as construction managers or supply chain managers cannot say that some requires 30 meter cube. Okay, if I bring the required number of transit mixers for it, it isn't working that way. So this sort of knowledge which you have already gained needs to be revised. In case you are not very confident on such parameters, please open your ISO 56, which tells you how to concrete under various conditions. Like for example, what is the maximum height a concrete can be dropped from. Okay. So coming back to my structure lecture, so these are some of the things which you need to look at. The requirement of the thing, what you are looking at, so what is the client's requirement, what are the things you need to consider as an engineer, and then there are a lot of things which you know about the material which is there, about the site. Okay, so I'll give you one more example. We are constructing chiller plants, it means we are going to have centralized AC for all the hospitals. Between Silver Jubilee Tower and the ladies hostel, a chiller plant is coming up. Look how much restricted the space is. It means I don't have space to put a crane. A crane can come, but then the outriggers don't have space. Even if you put the outriggers out somehow, the boom cannot lift it and turn. So now we are having a problem, right? Now we do have solutions for all of this. We will be talking about that. So if you look at it, you need to understand the specification. Before you buy something, you need to understand the specification. You need to know what is the way you are going to assemble it. Whether it's a site assembled truss, site welding you don't usually do, so that means if it requires site welding, what are the special cams you have to do? So some things like that you need to understand. You need to understand the material, what are the various components, because a structure is actually an assembly of components. You cannot look at only individual things. For example, now I am telling you, when you are thinking about the functional end requirement of this building, we should remember that there should be provisions made for lifting this to the height where we are going. So, the entire thing is not only really putting the concrete in and saying I have done my work, which we call as construction. So, all the methods which you are going to work on is going to come. So, it means construction management is going to encompass a lot of stuff. Okay. Now, I would like to just request all of you to just stand up for a minute. I have been talking for too long. Okay. Say hello to your neighbor and then sit down. Yes. Say hello and wake up your neighbors who might have been sleeping. And yeah. Anybody, if you would like to have some water, you are welcome to have. Okay. Now I've got a short video. Now this is something which I'm sure you guys will like.
Hey, I'm sitting below top.
I went up top of the skyscraper and wondered, who built this? An architect? An engineer? A builder? Well, yeah, all of these people play a role in designing and constructing a building. A project like this needs a team of hundreds of people, and like any great team, they need a leader. In fact, a project this huge needs a whole team of leaders. Let me introduce you to a few of them. Let's say a property developer has already selected the site and decided that it's ideal.
Just a minute. Let me
deal for a grand spanking.
Let me just turn on the mic here. Okay, that's perfect.
Skyscraper. Yeah. Where do we start? Call in the bulldozers and start preparing the site? Pour the concrete? Hold on, this is a huge project. We need to do a little planning first. So we've appointed Kim, a senior project manager, the leader of our team of leaders. Kim's got years of experience in this game. She will map out the whole process from start to finish. Who else? Well, there's Max, our design manager, who works with the architect and the engineer to design the perfect building. It's got to be beautiful, it's got to be functional, it's got to be really, really tall, and it's got to stay up. Max is pretty important. Without him on board, we could end up with a really dodgy building. Max gives the plans to Jamie, our quantity surveyor. He figures out how much it's all going to cost. It takes a huge pile of cash to build something on this scale. But without Jamie keeping an eye on the bottom line, it could take a massive pile of cash. Jamie works closely with Steve, the construction schedule. Steve's job is to figure out how long everything's going to take. Like, if it takes 10 workers 2.5 years to build a 20-story building, how long will it take 50 workers to build a 120-story building? Never mind. Let's just say that without Steve, it will take a really, really long time. What next? Don't we need some cranes and bulldozers? How about a plumber, painter, and an electrician? We sure do. That's why Amy, our contract manager, is organising all the contractors. The people who do all the hands-on stuff. Without Amy, well, not much will happen at all. Now we're ready to get started. Bring on the bulldozers, pour the concrete, and lay the footings. Up go the columns. In go the slabs, on goes the cladding, and that's pretty much it. We just need to connect the utilities, paint a few walls, tile some floors, and voila. One skyscraper delivered right on schedule. That last bit can take quite a while, anywhere between a few months and 2 years, actually. But don't worry, Kim was keeping an eye on things the whole time, making sure everyone did their job safely. Without her, who knows where we could have ended up. What do you think? Want to join this exciting team? Perhaps you're cut out for a career in construction management. The perks? Well, the prospects are great. In 2010, 96%.
This is
Have you looked up at a skyscraper?
This is a video by one of the
universities. So they have made that. I think it's a very nice video. It covers what we probably need to know about construction management. Basically, you will find that the scheduler, be it a person who is looking at the cost, or anybody who is working on the quantities, the estimator, all of them play a role. Only when they estimate and tell you how much to buy, you can buy. They cannot tell you, like, you know, I'll tell you tomorrow is completing, they cannot tell you today I need this much material. So as a supply chain manager, you will be behind all these people. The person who is monitoring the cost, he will help you decide the best vendor in the sense of the money which is allocated for you. So how best you can use that money. Everybody in this is very important. Okay. I am telling you that you can be any one of those roles. But in this course, we are specifically looking at how we can add value to the supply chain. Okay. Now, any good project starts with an idea. Somebody has an idea. They need to then understand, for example, this is a glass bridge in China. So, will this have been possible to have been done? That's the question probably people will ask. And then they will have to do some math initially. So, they do that and then they understand the resource. We usually come after the design is finished. Okay. But construction managers need to understand the legal aspects also. For example, labor welfare is something which we need to know, should be in our DNA. Contract, we need to understand. It also has to be something which is in our DNA so that we don't fall afoul with the legal agencies. We cannot think of doing work in a manner that we are cutting tax. Tax is a huge thing. 18% to 5% to 18% of your costs could be going. But you cannot be telling that, you know, I will work out ways by which I will not pay this tax. You could be in jail. Okay? Or your boss could be in jail. Again, finally, that's the schedules. Today, all this can be very easily done with intelligent 3D models. Okay. This 3D model is generated as part of a process. It's updated as part of a process. So, everybody has roles, everybody has well-defined responsibilities. So, when you have roles and responsibilities defined, you can work effectively. Mistakes can be reduced. Because you can do what is called as virtual construction. I think you guys remember the video where we saw. Virtual construction enabled that 35 centimeter could be the difference between the elevator which was working and the tunnel boring machine. Right? So, things like this are possible to be done with this 3D model. Currently, it's not very intelligent. Okay, we are but whatever work we are doing, we are trying to add intelligence to this 3D model. We are trying very hard to add the intelligence component to this 3D model. Okay, so I request all of you to get excited about these technologies. Try to get familiar with some of them. Okay, and this means effective, efficient planning is possible. You can plan the. If you are a construction manager, you planned already in advance. If you are a scheduler, you are putting the schedule probably even in a 3D way, because you can with Navisworks and things like that, you can make a time dependent model. Okay, tools are already available. So operational maintenance, still operational maintenance, everything is done. See, when you buy a spare part, for example, you are buying light fixtures. The light fixtures or fan, they require some maintenance. Okay, maybe lighting fan don't do it, but an air conditioning unit, air filter has to be cleaned every 3 months. So what happens is, this BIM model can be updated with all of this information. When, at the time when we buy this material, as a supply chain manager, you would have got the material. The moment you get the material, you are putting all the operation and the maintenance documents on the BIM platform. It means, for the end user, they don't have to worry what is the schedule I have to do for maintenance. So probably this is one way you are adding value in the chain. Okay. So again, so these are some of the things which BIM helps us to do, schedule stuff, work out logistics. See, for example, today the logistics have improved to the level that on Amazon you know where your parcel is. If they say that the material is going to reach you on a specific day, it is going to reach you. And look what also happens. The delivery person's phone number is put in. Right? So the amount of information which a company like Amazon is able to do is also possible for a company, for an organization like ours. In the sense that if you join an organization, you can implement all of this. Today many of the trucks are tracked with GPS. Okay. All the Hindustan Petroleum, and then, if I am not mistaken, Hindustan Petroleum trucks which transport fuel are monitored with GPS. So if you have that information, my truck with cement, 10 trucks are coming, one truck is not moving, it means automatically that something is wrong. You can always update the status. Your driver can send an SMS to tell that this is the thing, to a specific number. Automatically what will the system do? It will say this is the reason your material is going to get delayed by such and such time. So on and so forth. These are some of the things which BIM does. But the main thing is it's a single point of truth. It means if I want to know what is the latest schedule, I can go to the BIM portal and get the information. What is the latest quantity I require? It will be available in the BIM portal. I don't have to go and ask people what is to be done. Okay? So this triple constraint is something which will always be coming, will always be coming. And we, every person in the construction site is trying to add value to the chain. It means the scheduler is trying to compress the project time. It means the supply chain person has to bring the materials faster. When he is trying to bring it faster, it means if he is going to bring the material by airplane, is it going to be in the favor of the supply chain manager? Right? So it means that within the organization also you are going to have a lot of debates. So you need to have very solid evidence to prove that the action which you take is in the interest of the company. And when you show that a lot, you will become the next vice president. Okay? I mean it. Because you have put down everybody by logic. Okay? If you look at any company, the vice president and other people, they will have very good sense of working out logically. So logically you prove, although the scheduler is trying to say that the company saved so much of money, to bring this material in this time which he is asking, the premium which you are paying is so much more. So why don't we do it like this? So immediately the boss of the company is going to be more happy with you guys, right? In the same way, I am not saying that, you know, supply chain is the only way by which you save time. Whatever is the responsibility which you have, try to add value to that thing which you are doing. Okay? So construction is not only supply chain. That also I just will tell you. Remember that always you should plan well in advance. Planning is not only working out a schedule, planning is also communicating it correctly. Okay. Planning is not only thinking about from whom you are going to get the material, planning is also to communicate to others why you are choosing this and why they should not dispute your choice. People should not say later on that you could have done it differently. They should agree with you in full. You should have that strong, you should have had that much of backup information. So it means that before you do a plan, okay, but again, here are some other definitions of planning. Okay, so communication is one, and planning is a creative activity. Planning is a very creative activity. It means that you can modify a lot of stuff in your schedule to make it happen. Okay, and there is a lot of decision making involved in a plan. When I say decision, you take a decision based on information which you have. Okay? So basically you will find that who does something, what is to be done, when is to be done, okay, and how much of work has to be done. For example, I'll again go back to that sum. The 30 meter cube of concrete is how much? But I miss it on one day. So this is what we are always going to sit and do in your planning. If you order 30 meter cube of concrete on day one, 30 meter cube will land. What are you going to do that 30 meter cube? So this means that construction planning is very, very important, and you need to ensure that precedes all execution. It is a very, very important activity. It should be done first of everything. Okay, and then only all the other stuff is going to come. And again, when you plan, you need to also have some baseline support. Okay, that means something with which you are going to make a comparison. I want 10 meter cube of concrete to be done. If 8 is only done, why was it done? I want to buy 30 meter cube of concrete at the rate of say 5000 rupees per meter cube. So if it is going to 5500, there should be a proper reason for it. Or there is something wrong with the way you planned it out. Or there has been a lot of wastage. Something has happened. So this means the baseline is to be established. Please remember, you need to have the field data right. What is this field data? Whenever we go to start a new job, or whenever we are tendering for a job, we will go for a site visit. There we will see what is the locally available material. For example, what is skilled labor available for doing the work? How many ready-mix concrete plants are around this area? So if some of them have some additional quality certification, it is easier for us to work with such people because your quality assurance mechanism is already in place. Okay, and where can you keep the material? Is there enough store, is there land available cheap enough for you to make a warehouse? Again, we were working on our project for Reliance, Dahej. There were two parts. There was a part of the plant in the special economic zone, and there was another part of the plant which was in the normal tariff zone. If we are manufacturing the trusses and other equipment and other structures inside the plant, we are saving on tax. Lot of tax was being saved. So it means that you need to look at even these aspects. But suppose you are manufacturing in a particular area, maybe you are painting, and the waste paint is going, paint which might flow into the river is going to cause pollution which is unacceptable. It means that at the day one itself, you have to think of a way to overcome this challenge. Right? So maybe this will require a little bit of experience. But these are things probably which you should try to learn as you grow up the ladder also. Okay? So please remember, this field visit will play a very, very vital role. Okay? Now I wanted to show a video, but anyway, now I don't have much time, so I'll just say thank you and close the lecture for today. I hope you found it informative, and yes, is there anything you'd like to ask here, please? Yes, please. Alright, okay, that punch list is on this slide, huh? Okay, it's, where is it? Back. This one? Okay. Right, here. See, punch list, whenever you are working on a contract, you try for close out. What is close out? The contractor is given a certificate by the owner that all the works in the contract have been successfully and satisfactorily completed. Okay, after that point, what is called as performance guarantee will start. Now, if the performance guarantee is for 1 year, anything goes wrong in 1 year, you will have to pay. So punch list will be prepared by the owner to say that certain things are not to the satisfaction. For example, Q block, the door is not closing properly. So that will become a punch list. In room number 213, this is not to my satisfaction. So the contractor will close all these issues and prepare, will say that, you know, it's like punching that out and stating that that is closed. That's a punch list. Okay? Yeah, close out means the contractor is given a certificate stating that the project is completed. And punch list is like a checklist, but then usually what we call a checklist is, for example, you finish this painting of the doors and windows. The, is the window closing properly? Yes, yes, yes. If the checklist is not working, something is not right, we feel the contract cannot be closed. Then we create another list called punch list. Donor will create one more list called punch list. It's also like a checklist, but it is having a different meaning. If you satisfy the things in the punch list, contract can be considered closed. Which one?
BIM.
BIM. What is BIM? BIM is Building Information Model. Okay, that's the 3D. It's a process which is centered around a 3D model. Okay. Great. Thank you for the questions. Any other questions, please? Which one? BIM, Building Information Model. You can just take this down and have a look at, Google it up and learn. Okay, there's a lot to learn in that. Right. So, okay, I'll stop now. I have to run to another class also. So, bye for now.